all of us cannot ignore the importance of observational studies that has come up, and now I think it is time to implement certain regulations and certain guidelines so that observational studies are, you know, more robust in how we are conducting and how we are publishing them. Is this working? Okay. So these are the points which I am going to cover. Some amount of basics of observational studies and how is observational study as compared to the RCT, and the need for registration of observational studies, what are the ethical considerations for observational studies, ethical obligations while going for publication. So publication is not something that was discussed in today's session till now, but my experience and my expertise is majorly in publication, so I would be touching upon this also. And I'm going to take a couple of case studies from the Committee of Publication Ethics, which are specific to observational studies and their publications, and some cases around that. As we see observational study, they should be considered as a complementary rather than a rival analytic technique. So it is not observational study versus RCT, but observational study as a continuation of RCT, or observation or RCT as a continuation of our observational study. So both of them are complementary to each other. And this is especially important for assessing rare adverse events where clinical trials are not possible due to ethical considerations and long-term effectiveness, because clinical trials are normally conducted in very stringent and very, you know, confined kind of environment where the inclusion criteria are very strict and the exclusion criteria too. So in observational studies, since we look after the data or the patients which are in the real world evidence in the clinical practice, so many situations might arise which were not covered in the clinical trials. Off-label indications may come up there. Intervention is not determined by the protocol but by the clinical practice. So whatever the doctor is practicing, so based on that the observational studies are routinely conducted. The main problem with an observational study, the biggest flaw of observational study, is obviously the presence of confounders and selection bias. So because of these two factors, the role of observational study and the authenticity of observational study is sometimes questioned. But there are some propensity score-based sensitivity analysis methods, so some specific statistical methods and techniques which are applied on the data, which could drastically reduce the bias due to the lack of randomization which was there. Now, there are some of the common biases which are there in observational studies. So we have selection bias, we have information bias, measurement errors and confounding errors. And some amount of information about the bias and how to prevent them would definitely help us to come up with observational studies which are more robust. The common types of observational studies are, as all of us know, cross-sectional study, ecological study, case control, and cohort study. This is just a small recap from the epidemiology classes which we had. I have a very interesting study where RCTs were compared with observational studies in terms of the point estimates. And the published meta-analysis, this examined the same clinical topics were evaluated to compare their outcomes. 5 clinical topics and 99 reports were evaluated in this meta-analysis. The average results of the observational study were found to be similar to those of RCT in the terms of summary estimates and the confidence intervals. So the conclusion from this study was that well-designed observational studies do not systematically overestimate the magnitude of the effects of treatment as compared to those in RCTs on the same topic. So I just have that result which was there. So one was the study was on BCG and the relation with tuberculosis. You just can concentrate on the summary estimates here. So the first one is for the RCT and the second value is for the case control or observational study. And you do not see any significant difference among the two. So this was there for all the 5 clinical conditions which were studied in this meta-analysis. So mammography and mortality from breast cancer, again, there is not much of a difference. So the point estimates and the confidence intervals are same. This is again hypertension and stroke, and treatment of hypertension and coronary heart disease. Again, the difference is 0.58, 0.62. So this meta-analysis in itself is a very good proof that if observational study is conducted properly by taking care of the bias and the confounding factors, then it is as good as a RCT to evaluate the effectiveness of the drug or of the, of any intervention. Now this is a very interesting paper which I came across. This had to do with the FDA action which FDA took in 2008. FDA published an early communication about an ongoing safety review of evacuate and detanocin in HIV patients. And this publication of FDA was based on an observational study of 33,347 HIV-1 infected patients living in North America, Europe and Australia. And there were short and long-term adverse effects of treatment with anti-HIV drugs which were evaluated. And there was associated increased risk of heart attack with these drugs. So there were similar studies which were conducted by the sponsors also. GSK and BMS were the sponsors here, and the studies which were conducted by sponsors were inconclusive. So they could not associate these drugs with the increased risk of heart attack, nor they could refute it. So the FDA believed that results were incomplete and advised the healthcare providers to evaluate the potential risk and benefit of each HIV-1 antiretroviral drug that the patients are taking, and this included these two drugs also. So this was an action which was taken by FDA, and this was based on an observational study which was published. Now, the next step is registration of observational studies. We did discuss some amount in how registrations are done, whether they're mandatory or not. Now, why do we register a clinical trial? So I'm going to start from there, that why is the registration of clinical trial important? Because we have a respect for human participants. It's evidence-based medicine. The mitigation of publication bias, any detection of any deviations which are there, peer documentation methods, any gaps in the research are identified, avoidance of duplication. Once the study is registered, everybody in the science community knows about the study and they might not replicate the same study and for public record. So all these above rationales which are there for clinical trial are actually applicable for observational studies also. The above rationale applies to observational studies also, hence systematic prospective registration of observational studies is required. So the requirement is there. Now let's go ahead and see that what is the actual scenario, what is happening. So I've just tried to trace what clinicaltrials.gov has about registration of observational study. In February 2000, the clinicaltrials.gov website was launched, and it accommodates registration of observational studies since its launch. So the option is there, you can go and register your observational study, but it is not mandatory. So there are investigators and sponsors who do go and register the observational studies. Then the next update came in October 2007, when the Congress, the US Congress passed an AAA and requirement for the submission expanded. So this was design specific data elements to be used for registering observational studies. So there was a guideline which was launched during that same time, which is by the name of stroke statement. And this comes under a reporting guideline, but under a broader umbrella, which is available at a website, quitor.org. And all the publication writers and medical writers, actually, it's a Bible for them, and we follow these reporting guidelines. So this is a strengthening and a reporting of observational studies and epidemiology statements. So this came up in 2007. And in September 2008, actually, the prospective registration public disclosure of study results, they were made obligated. Like, so ethical obligations were there to actually register. Prospective registrations were mandatory. Database of summary results that allows for reporting of many of the results related items identified in the stroke initiative. So this is how the clinicaltrials.gov has evolved related to observational study. Now there were some certain registration trends of observational studies between 2000 and 2010. I could not get any data after 2010 on the number of observational studies that are conducted and what are the trends. So in the study design, the most common study design of observational study was prospective observational study. In the number of registrations, observational studies represent about 15% of all studies registered at any given year in clinicaltrials.gov. So this data, what is presented, the trends which are there are only based on the clinicaltrials.gov. There was geographic distribution study. Study locations of observational studies were 50% in North America, 20% in Europe, and 13% in Asia. So this was the percentage of registered observational studies from these three main regions. In type of sponsorships, this is one point which was opposite to the RCT observational study. In 85% are funded by non-industry sources, so probably the investigator-initiated trials or institution-sponsored trials, observational studies, in contrast to 64% of interventional studies. So in, the non-industry sources for interventional studies are 64%, and for observational studies is 85%. The registration rate, again, like diseases and conditions which were studied, this was almost similar. So there was not any specific disease which was most common for which the RCTs were conducted or for which the observational studies were conducted. So there was not much of a difference between the disease conditions. So they all are actually disease conditions. Now, what are the gaps in registration of observational studies? Prospective cohort studies are the most frequently registered, as it's obvious, like you are planning a study and you are going to follow it up, so probably it is easier for the person, and it comes to the investigators or sponsors mind to get it registered. Retrospective data collections are something which normally don't get registered. Secondary data analysis evaluations are not always registered. Difficulties in delineating individual studies from a broad plan. So sometimes there is a broad data which is there, and the investigator, doctor, or sponsor wants some studies to come out of the broad data. So that in that case, probably registration is not possible because they are not sure about what kind of data analysis they want, what kind of studies they would be looking forward to. There is no re-studies or analysis using the same prospective data. So there is a lot of confusion where data is there and how to present it, what to register. So when you're registering, you need to have a very robust protocol with you, that what you would be doing, what endpoints will be there, what variables will be there. So if you're not sure about what you want to do with the data, you will not be able to register the study. No clarity on the data elements and specific structure, as we just discussed. Now, these are the four questions actually which comes to anybody's mind when we are talking about observational study. First is listing observational study in a research registry a good use of resource? So this is something, because everything will take time, will take space. There will be a back-end support which will be required to keep all the information proper and make it available to public or to regulatory bodies. So we really need to define whether it is essential for us to do the registrations compulsory. Where should the observational studies be listed? So should it be in the existing registries which are already there, or probably a separate registry which is more lenient towards observational studies, and which you can maybe, if you have a plan or a proposal, you can put up there and probably make some changes or some modifications later on. So not as stringent as the protocol amendments which are made, but maybe something which is more flexible, seeing that this data is coming from a real world evidence or a clinical practice. And some more permutations, combinations should be allowed so that the science and the innovations which are there in the doctor's mind are given proper credit, and we do get some good results from there. And what components of prospective observational studies in particularly should be listed and why? And should there be some incentives for the researchers to list their observational studies? So we do have all this for RCTs clarity there, but we need probably some clarity on observational studies now. Now, coming to the ethical considerations for observational study, safeguarding the rights of the stakeholders. Now, everything starts with declaration of health sensitivity and clinical research. It specifies that for all the interventional studies and biomedical research, this needs to be followed. This term is definitely there in many of the countries' regulations that ethical approvals are required if the study is on a biomedical research or an interventional study. So there are some countries, and the situation is actually very confusing for observational study, no clear guidelines there. There was a systematic review of guidelines on observational studies, that what were the guidelines which are followed for observational studies. So I've just highlighted three of the points in this, where the proportion which they have addressed is very less. So you see that a review of prior research is almost 6 or 9 study objectives. So all these are standard things which everybody was aware of and they were addressed. But when you come with communication with stakeholders, only 2 of the papers actually address it out of 9. Then there's one on heterogeneity or treatment effect, where only 3 out of 9 addressed it. The most difficult was the ethics committee IRB approval, only 3 out of 9 addressed, and they could not come up. So this is the only option which is there, which you know gives a no. So they could not come up with any proper, you know, recommendation or a proper guideline whether it should be done or not. So the number of people who were aware of it or who wanted to address the issue was less. Plus, there was no clear message from the study also. And another one which was there was dissemination. So even this was, there were authorship guidelines, there were differences there. Even this did not have any clear choice which was offered. So you can see only 3 guidelines address the ethical considerations of observational study out of 9, and that too did not address any actionable steps for ethics. So normally there are, you know, whenever we do systematic reviews or meta-analysis, we do have some key take-home messages which, you know, are normally at the end of the paper, which we try to tell that this is a gap which is there and we should be addressing it like this. But for ethical considerations in observational study, that is not the case. Now there are different countries who have different rules. Ethics committee in some countries can waive for the committee approval as there is no experimental observation. Canada is the only country which says all research that involves living subjects requires review and approval by IRB before the research is started. This even includes research involving review of patient records. So this is the only country which has a very clear guideline and a very clear recommendation on what is required. Turkey is another country. Turkey has a recommendation for the prospective study, but for retrospective studies, they are excluded from this code. In Europe and USA, again, it is all biomedical research for them. Europe is very clear. It's clearly written that biomedical research are the only studies which should be, you know, which should undergo ethical approvals. Several, there were some French observational studies which were conducted in France, and they wanted to publish the paper in US, but the papers got rejected, but because they were not ethically approved. So their protocols have not been submitted to IRB and IECs. As per European directive, only biomedical research needs an approval. So this situation is always there. The study is conducted in a different country and you want to publish the paper in a different country. So this will come there. Like if you have conducted in a country where ethical approval is not required and you want to submit it to a journal where ethical approval is required, then you will not be able to do that. Now, this is a case study on ethics approval when country of study is different from country of publication. So the first case that I'm discussing is studies from different countries may not have ethics committee approval and authors may claim that their study does not need approval. So any research, whether it is retrospective analysis or routine patient data. So there are 2 countries which are mentioned here, country A and country B. So in country A, it was that all the studies required ethics committee approval, and in country B, the ethics committee approval is not required for such studies. So the journal has received both the studies, one from country A and one for country B, neither has ethics committee approval, and then the journal had to give their decision. The questions for the COPE forum were, what should be the best editorial practice in this situation when you're getting a paper like this? Either accept both papers for review, accept the paper from country B for review, but reject the paper for country A and reject both papers. So now, what COPE did after this? The forum noted that editors cannot be expected to know the national guidelines of a country. So it's obvious the editor cannot go back and see the guidelines, what are there in the country. It is up to the authors to make sure that they comply with their national guidelines and also comply with the journal guidelines. So one suggestion was that the national standards where the research was done should apply here, or the editor could make a judgment on his own national standard in the country where the journal is located. So for country A, what they said was, where ethics committee approval is required, the forum suggested that editor investigate whether the research does need ethics approval. So the editor actually went back to the country's bodies, and there they kind of had a discussion with them. And then similarly for country B, the forum suggested asking for a proof that the study did not require ethics approval. So if ethics committee approval is not required, then probably a letter of exemption can be given to the journal just to tell them that, you know, ethics committee approval was not required in my country. So the follow-up what happened after this was, editorial board of the journal reviewed the forum's recommendations and decided to continue to ask ethics committee approval for every study submitted to the journal from all countries. So what they decided was that from now onwards, we will be asking for ethics committee approval for all the studies wherever they are conducted. If the study requires ethics approval, the authors will be asked to provide this. And if they cannot provide, the journal will reject the manuscript and contact the institutions if necessary. So this is just a case where you'll understand how the situation is gray. It is not black and white. There are many parameters which are there which need to be, you know, seen. And so now going for publications of an observational study. In the ICMJE recommendation, it's mentioned that the research, either it is approved or exempted from the need for review by the responsible review committee. So you just have to mention there. So there is no ICMJE recommendation yet for specific observational studies. In JAMA, actually, it's mentioned principles outlined in the Declaration of Helsinki should be followed. So again, observational studies separately are not mentioned here. In BMJ, again, the ethical approval of research says it expects the authors to follow the World Medical Association's Declaration of Helsinki. In BMJ, some of the other points which are captured in the journal are, all research done on humans should have a protocol. So even the observational study should have a protocol, actively supports the registration of observational study protocols and results in publicly accessible registries. Responsibility lies on researchers, peer reviewers, and editors for publication of good quality work. So this is definitely a team effort where researchers, peer reviewers, and editors, all three of them have to work hand in hand, you know, understand what the requirements are and comply according to the recommendations. Ask the authors to tell about origins, motivations, and data interrogation methods. Observational study should not be rejected just because it did not have a pre-specified hypothesis. Because this is the most important problem which majority of us face. We really do not know what are we going to find out in the observational study. So you may get a comorbid condition or maybe an off-label indication which comes up later on in the study. So you cannot be sure at the stage of registration what the hypothesis would be, but should explore the research question and its design and fully report it. So the final actually key message of the whole situation is, it's always better to take approval or opinion from ethics committee before commencing any observational study and getting it published. So I would like to know if anybody of you have any questions or any experiences to share. I would really like to, you know, understand from this gathering that what have they come across, what are the specific difficulties or, you know, issues which have come across them.
I Hi, I'm Dr. Shahu from MK Pharmaceuticals. I have a couple of questions. You have mentioned that in clinicaltrials.gov, almost 15% of the studies have been registered as an observational studies. But if you see in India, it is not mandatory. So what are those factors which will propel the investigators to register their observational study at clinicaltrials.gov?
So that was actually one of the questions which I had put in between. So the facility is there for investigator to go and register, but there is no recommendation, no rule which is asking them to do so. It's more on a voluntary basis yet, and people who are aware of it or who are looking at it, that you know they would be planning of submitting it to a good journal, normally get their paper studies registered. Because they know once you go to a good journal, the ethical approvals and registrations would be required. So that is the area where they do get registered. But yes, that is definitely a gap which we all are facing now, and probably some regulations and some more, you know, clarity on guidelines are required on this. And there are no incentives or, you know, any other factors which can help the investigator or, you know, provoke the investigator to go and get the observational studies registered.
Okay. And whatever the data which you have shown for clinicaltrials.gov, it was for 2002 to 2010.
Right.
And we are in 2017. So does it mean that no studies have been registered so far, the observational studies?
The majority, I could not get a very valid source where observational studies percentages I could get. So the percentages which I have got around 2015-16 is around 20% of observational studies are registered. So it was 15% till 2010 and then around 20% after that. But yes, now as a medical writer and as a medical communicator, I am getting a lot of responses from sponsors and investigators to conduct observational studies along with ethical approvals also a part of the initial project. So they say that they have data and they want ethics committee approval to be there. So definitely that awareness is there and things are catching up and they are moving in that direction. But it is more from a voluntary perspective, maybe, you know, because of their own legal or their own compliance, internal compliance issues which are there, which is, you know, making them do that.
Thank you.
Do we have any other questions?
So when you showed the table where there were no significant differences in the class intervals between RCTs and these studies, what kind of numbers were they? Were they risk measures or something else?
They were point estimates.
Okay.
They were point estimates and confidence intervals. So basically they were the final outcomes which were like you would have seen the associations between mortality and disease or breast cancer awareness. So they were those clear associations which they had
estimated. So some kind of survival analysis or time to event?
Yes, it was similar actually in both the cases for RCT as well as for observational studies.
Okay, and in terms of propensity scores, the basic model is a logistic model. Mm-hmm. Okay, has there been any evolution in that direction?
I'm not a statistician. Okay. That background I don't have, so I just know that I read about it. I know that, you know, that if you do this propensity scores, probably the factors, the biases we will be able to, and the randomization which is a part of RCT that is taken care of observational study if we are doing these. So probably a statistician would be a better person to answer.
No problem.
On that.
Very nice presentation delivered by you, and congratulate to you. Just I wanted to know, like you have mentioned observational study. So do you mean observational means retrospective or prospective or both?
It's everything. It's actually observational studies. You would have prospective, retrospective, both. You will have a cohort study or a case control study. So everything comes under observational study. So basically you can say any non-interventional study which is there would come under observational study.
Okay. Actually, you know, we do publish observational study, but few journals, yes, they are definitely asked for EC approval or, you know, like some registration like CTRI or some other registrations. But not, I think, compulsory.
Yeah, it is not compulsory yet. So some journals are asking, or you have to give a letter there that you had applied for it and your ethics committee or your the IRB which is there in your hospital has exempted you. So either you give that letter to the journal or you give approval. So it actually depends upon your own institution's rule as of now. So whether the IRB is giving approvals on observational studies or not. So the thing is actually at that stage. So if they are giving, then you are giving the approvals to the journal. If they are giving that, you know, you do not require ethics committee approvals, then you should take a letter of exemption from the IRBs or IECs and give that to the journal when you are publishing.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's give a round of applause for that excellent presentation.